So thank you, Anna, very much for the kind introduction. And I would also like to thank Manuel very much for the invitation to be part of this talk series. I'm very honored to be part of such a lineup. And I hope we have a very interesting exchange with the audience today. I'm very much looking forward to hearing your comments and your questions. And here you see my outline. And let us start by very briefly discussing these three clocks we have to cope with or that we live by and that we study in circadian biology research. So if we were in an environment with no technology, we would probably compute time also consciously considering day-night transitions. Also, the first technologies developed use the position of the sun in the sky to reckon time of day. But then other technologies started being used from the moment payrolls depended on work times. So you have to be at work at the right time. And other social commitments are also now scheduled on local time. And then we have the biological clock, the so-called circadian system, this temporal program that orchestrates biology at different scales from the cellular level to the systemic and behavior. And this program, as we know, uses light as an important time cue or a Zeitgeber to entrain to the environment. And other time cues such as eating and physical activity, they may happen at times that are not aligned with these light arc cycles. And this may cause clocks to lose their cohesion and tempo or make their timings misaligned. And if we move social time away from our light arc cycles, we may be burdening the system. And the one classic example of burdening the system is, of course, a shift work or the symptoms one has because they abruptly change their light arc cycles when traveling. But there is also an even more prevalent phenomenon, which is a burden to the system, and that can be easily quantified. So the darker days and the brighter nights of our modern lifestyles, they produce later phases of entrainment. And then if many people now sleep and wake up later, but they still have to go to work early, that relatively new technology, the alarm clock, becomes of utmost need. And then on free days, many people do not have such a strain. And this difference between sleep timing on work days and on free days is called social jet lag. And it represents to some degree this discrepancy between social and biological times. And it is calculated as the difference between the center of the sleep episode on free days and work days. And one way to get this data is to compute social jet lag. One way to get the data is using self-reported sleep times that we can get, for example, with a Munich chronotype questionnaire. But we could also derive a social jet lag from other sleep assessments like diaries or actigraphy, as long as they have information on which days are work days, which days are free days, and also as long as they are a good representation of you know, work days and free days in the data, meaning, for example, that you have enough days for assessing that. So we talked of social jet lag because it is a measure of circadian burden that we usually use, and I will show you some results. But I would also like to show another two examples of metrics that we often use, and those we derive from actigraphy, these long recordings that we get from actimeters on activity and also light exposure, if there is a light sensor in the actimeter, which is the case of the one we use, the device we use. And one of these metrics that we derive from ActiData is interdaily stability, which quantifies stability or invariability between days. On the left, for example, you see that throughout the day, someone that has activity is starting at different times of the day. And this results in a lower IES or a lower stability as compared to this example on the right, which is more regular. But then please keep in mind that this considers this metric, it considers invariability in the entire signal. I used activity onset as an example, but it considers invariability in the entire signal of activity and not only activity onset as I used to exemplify it. Then intradaily variability is another metric. and it represents how consolidated or fragmented the rhythm is. So when you have more abrupt transitions from moments of high and low activity, as you see again in the example on the left, you have more fragmentation than you have here on the right when the rhythm is a bit more consolidated. And we have been very interested in studying circadian burden in real life conditions in humans with a special focus on behavior and health. And I'm going to show you results of two large studies in such a context. And the first of them was born at the beginning of the pandemic in one of our speed up moments at work when entire cities were slowing down with empty streets. And we started populating screens as never before. And when the pandemic started, we predicted some potential changes related to these three clocks we live by and considering circadian biology research that I told you about. And the first of them was that we thought that work times would be more flexible, which would decrease this discrepancy of social and biological clocks. We also thought that a natural light exposure would decrease with staying longer at home. Then that other temporal cues would be less consistent, for example, eating times. And finally, we thought that the incidence of insomnia and anxiety levels would increase, and that would affect sleep. And since many people only get darkness when they are asleep these days, we thought that this would eventually affect their light exposure as well. And because there is overwhelming evidence in the literature of this association between disrupted circadian organization and psychiatric disorders, we asked ourselves back then if circadian organization would be associated with mental health in the pandemic. And to address that question, and I'll tell you about the second question on the previous slide later on, but to address that first question, we designed these two related studies. So one of them, we collected in the study questionnaires, data online at three different time points, as you see here, and they were separated by 14 days. And this was a quite large sample, relatively large sample. And then one study in which we collected data now from less people, but that is a very powerful data set in the sense that we have a lot of information on each subject. And I'm going to show now some results on cross-sectional data from this first time point of the service study in which we had a larger sample size. We included almost 1,400 subjects in our analysis, and most of them were women, and they were between, most of them between 18 and 45 years old, and from the states of Rio Grande do Sul and São Paulo in Brazil. And I wanted to stress that because many convenient samples that were collected during the pandemic have this characteristic of being composed by more women and younger people. So when you're seeing these results and interpreting them, please keep that in mind with our results. And for these participants, we asked how regular were their sleep routines, their eating, work, and exercise times. And we attributed to each of these four items a score of 0, 1, or 2 if they were either absent, irregular, or regular. And then we summed them, and the four summed up to a score of 2 to 8, with 8 meaning more regular behaviors. And what we saw is that having regular behaviors correlated negatively with PHQ-9 and GAD-7, which are scales that assess prevalence and severity of depressive and anxiety symptoms. So the more regular, the less symptoms our participants had. And also we saw that being regular correlated positively now with well-being as assessed by the WHO-5 scale. So when we have a score of 2, we know that sleeping and eating are absent and that sleeping and eating are irregular and that working and exercise are absent behaviors. And when we have a score of 8, we know that all the behaviors are regular. But then we have intermediate scores that can represent very different combinations of these four behaviors being absent, regular, or irregular. And we selected 10 most common combinations to see what would happen then. And these 10 most common combinations represent more than 60% of the sample. And what we saw was very similar patterns, with well-being being higher among the people who are more regular, and depressive and anxiety symptoms being lower. And please note that you cannot compare the lines between them here, because we have different intervals that each of these three scales can take. But the idea here is to really see how anxiety and depression are still lower on the more regular side, and well-being is higher. And we wouldn't choose for using proportions here in the y-axis in our plot, so that clinicians can still interpret results, knowing of, you know, average values in the literature and suggested cutoffs for categories of severity of disease. Here you see a generalized linear model with standardized coefficients. And in this model, we entered each item, each behavior separately. And because these are standardized coefficients, we can compare them. And I want to draw your attention to the fact that sleep is the behavior for which regularity is more closely associated with the outcomes. So less depressive symptoms, less anxiety symptoms, and higher well-being. And then we wondered how this could be different for different chronotypes. And we estimated chronotype from self-reported mid-sleep on free days. And you see that the slope is steeper for people with earlier and even intermediate MSF than for people with the late MSF, with people showing even less depressive symptoms when they are quite regular, and then more symptoms if they were on the most regular side. And one hypothesis we have is that lay types may often be sort of forced to be regular at times that are far from their right times, or farther from their right times, according to the internal clock. But this, of course, remains to be tested. We also see here that more people with a late MSF seem to show lower regularity. Here, you see in dark blue late MSFs, and you see that the distribution is more towards low regularity, and also higher scores on the depressive symptom scale. So we tested a mediation model that supported the plausibility of routines being a mediator of the association between MSF and PHQ-9. So it really supported the plausibility of that. And for that, we used individuals for which we had data on the second time point, so as to use a PHQ-9, the depressive symptom score, collected after the reporting of regularity. But we still acknowledge that with this design, we cannot really confirm directionality, but it is an interesting finding supporting the hypothesis that regular behaviors may protect mental health. And what we believe in is that it is a virtuous cycle in which regular behaviors promote mental health, which in its turn promotes healthy behaviors, including keeping these behaviors regular. Now in the same study, but with an earlier and then a smaller sample, which is the data we collected only until early September 2020, we saw that many people at that time were able to choose their work or study schedules. And among those who could choose their schedules, we saw longer sleep duration and a lower social jet lag. And now I'm just going to briefly illustrate the power of the second data set, since we're still exploring it. But here we also tried for a more evenly distributed sample in terms of age and sex. And we collected self-reported daily data on sleep, mood, well-being, and physical symptoms over 44 days. And the same participants also wore actimeters during that time, meaning we have long recordings and 1 minute intervals of activity and light exposure over the same 44 days, plus batteries of questionnaires pre and post those 44 days. And analyzing actimetry data in a way that renders it ready for what we want to do takes many important steps. We already identified off-wrist, which is when, of course, the subject takes off the ACTI. And we used an algorithm that we developed and tested in our lab and that showed a fairly good performance. And I'm just going to keep some days here so that you see, so that I can zoom in and show you here in red what the algorithm detects. And we also visually inspected all these ectograms to make sure we had off-risk well identified. And finally, we are recollecting data so that we have a share of those subjects who are in two different contexts. So in 2020, when they were mostly working and working from home, and now when most activities are back to being in person. And this data set was really designed with this goal of exploring the relationship between mental health and disrupted rest activity rhythms. And what we wanted was to be able not only to compare individuals between them, but also to compare the same individual in different contexts. I'm now going to show you examples of three individuals for which we have already finished data collection in 2022 to show the potential of the data set and how we hope to see what kind of patterns of activity and sleep in different contexts we may find. So in the ectograms I'm showing you, you see in blue activity, light exposure is in yellow, and these gray bars and purple bars are sleep estimated from actigraphy, with purple standing for weekends, sleep on weekends. And in this first case, you see an adolescent or young adult who was very late in 2020. You see here that his sleep onset seems to be on average 6 a.m. When he had social distancing that was very strict, right? But he was still very regular in his sleep times as per the estimation from actigraphy. And interestingly, it was on weekends that he would eventually now and then wake up earlier, as you see here in the purple bars. And in 2022, he was earlier than in 2020, but then also less regular. Now here we have a different case of an adult with more irregular sleep times in 2020. But then with what seems to be longer sleep durations in 2020 than in 2022, which is still quite irregular. And also in 2022, we see some weeks of very marked social jet lag here with the sleep times on weekends being very late. And then finally, we have an older adult who sleeps very similar in both situations. So this was only to illustrate how we can investigate such patterns and see how they also correlate with mental health. But as usual in science, we ended up with conclusions from what we have seen so far, but also with some new questions. And from what we have seen in this study and in the literature regarding more flexible work times, we keep asking ourselves if what was considered normal before the pandemic was actually healthy. And maybe we can take advantage of this time of redefining what is normal. And then the fact that regularity in routines was associated with mental health also points out that advice on some modifiable behaviors can be used to promote health from a circadian perspective. Now I would like to go back a bit further in time and discuss other important determinants of changes in our relationship with time and circadian organization, and that is industrialization and electricity. And to study those, we have been working on another project that assesses behavior in real life conditions. As I said earlier, electricity and industrialization moved us to spend most time indoors, which produces on average later phases of entrainment and sleep time. And that is because we now have a weaker environmental time cue to entrain our internal clocks, or weaker timekeeper, since we have darker days and brighter nights. And with sleep being often later now and work times being often early, the discrepancies between social and body clocks have increased, and so did sleep deprivation. And we also hypothesized that industrialization increased irregularity in rest activity rhythms. And our lab has been interested in comparing contexts of weak and strong time cues or zeitgebers in real life for a while. And the group thought a good way to do so was to study rural and urban populations. And in Brazil, even in the South, people's diversity gets attention. So our group started studying a rural area in Vale do Taquari, which was mainly populated by German and Italian immigrants. And in this study, 20% of the total population of Vale do Taquari was sampled. The participants were locals of European descent, German and Italian, whose ancestors migrated to this region between 1824 and 1870. And these communities are culturally and ethnically homogeneous, and one can find rural farming areas and small towns. And in the study, 2,515 rural workers and 3,427 urban workers were included. And what our group saw is that sleep was later in the urban population, social jet lag was larger, and average exposure to sunlight was lower in the urban population. From what our group learned during field work, the people in Vale do Taquari, they still had a quite strict notion of time and work times. For example, they really thought that waking up early would mean being productive. And they also, even if they used it less, they had access to electricity. So we asked ourselves, what about communities in which this sense of work schedules is not as much tied to local times? And what about people who live without electricity? And to assess that and investigate associations with health, we started a project on Quilombola communities, which have similar sociocultural characteristics, but who live at different stages of urbanization. And here you can see where in the south of Brazil, the communities we included in the first paper are located, the first paper we published on this study. And we collected data from a community that has no access to electricity to one that is still rural, but that had had access to electricity for longer than 30 years. And as you can see here, what we saw was that communities that had had electricity for longer do sleep later, and some, whereas not all of them, do sleep shorter than the community with no electricity. And what you see here is data from actigraphy, sleep derived from actigraphy, but we found very similar results with self-reported data using the MCDQ. The results in the literature are also heterogeneous in terms of sleep duration in communities with no electricity. And these differences are often discussed as to what are the characteristics of the communities. For example, are they agricultural, pastoralists, hunter-gatherers? Here in our study, all the communities were in rural areas. But what we think is that they may vary in the way they subordinate productivity to time and, of course, in the way they use electricity. So does waking up early mean being productive for them? And I like to show this sayings of one of the members of the community with no electricity to illustrate that. And it goes along the lines of, in the city, it is easier to get tired. It is a matter of time. During the day, everything is as soon as the clock tells. Here we work when the sun tells us to. And I also always like to take a moment to think how recent all of this is. In the end of the 19th century, people were still considering how much of a development electricity would bring by providing artificial light and distributing it to each individual house. And then see this early sign here stating that the room was equipped with electric light that should not be lit with a match and which should not affect the soundness of sleep. And now with our knowledge, we'd like to differ since electric light is affecting sleep in some way. So we showed that sleep patterns seem to have changed due to modern lifestyles. And now let us think about what I like to call a circadian health in that context. And we have hypothesized, as it recently came out in this paper by Professor Runeberg and collaborators that circadian health, meaning a well-functioning temporal program in which we have optimal phases relationships, so that circadian health associates with general health. And here I show you that activity interdaily stability is also lower in urban communities or those rural with electricity than in the community that has no access to electricity. And we also see how it is correlated with the patterns of light exposure in the morning and evening on this plot on the right. So the more light you get in the morning as opposed to the evening, the higher the stability. And I like this plot because you can also see here in yellow how variable the light exposure is in the city and how less variable it is in the community with no electricity, which is in purple here. And also how the dots in purple from this community with no electricity tend to be more here on the top right quadrant, which is the one of high stability and high Zgibber strength. Now we have different metrics we extract from behavioral data that indicate under how much burden the system is. And I showed you some data, told you about some examples, for example, with social jet lag, interdaily stability and intradaily variability. But we are interested in seeing how such metrics relate to health. And in the Quilombola sample, the rural Quilombola sample, we saw that among people who have social jet lag higher than 1 hour, there was a higher proportion of subjects with back depression inventory score higher than 10, which we consider to indicate clinically significant depressive symptoms. And having clinically significant symptoms was also associated with lower light exposure during the day as measured per the light sensors in the actimeters. And here you see group profiles of both groups, one with what we consider clinically significant depressive symptoms in orange, and then in blue, those who do not have them. And in these group profiles, you already see that this difference seems to be very important in the morning. And when we compared median light exposure from 8 to 10 a.m., we also see a significant difference with the group of having clinically significant depressive symptoms also showing lower median light exposure. And light in the evening was not significantly different in this sample. Then in her master thesis, Deborah looked at the relationships of circadian burden with BMI in the Quilombola sample, but now with an urban level added. And she saw that a higher IV of activity and light exposure, meaning more fragmented rhythms of those two, was associated with overweight and obesity. Also, those who were obese, they were exposed to less light during their 10 hours of higher light exposure. And we also saw that living in highly urbanized communities was associated with increased odds of being overweight or obese. And because we saw different metrics related to different health aspects, we are now building the concept of a health index to investigate how health aspects overlap, which metrics are good predictors of the health disease balance in general, and in the future, which kinds of disturbance to the system may be associated with different diseases, since we may eventually have good and affordable methods that give us a better notion of internal alignment. And this illustrates how we need standardized and well understood methods to better translate to clinics, and we have been interested in dissecting and better characterizing those in the lab, in our group. But we already have some useful information that can be put to use. And to illustrate that, I will go back to the study with which I started the presentation, the one we carried out during the pandemic. And while designing our studies in the beginning of the pandemic, we had a second question, which was, are recommendations on healthy habits and circadian organization effective to promote mental health? And within that survey study, to address that question, we additionally delivered recommendations to our participants at time point one, after they filled in the first battery of questionnaires. And we asked them how much they followed these recommendations 14 and 28 days after that. And just restating, to assess depressive and anxiety symptoms, we used the PHQ-9 and JD7, sorry. And these recommendations, they were organized in three volumes. Volume one was COVID-19 protective measures, which were general COVID-related recommendations, such as wearing masks and washing your hands. And then the second volume was on healthy habits, which included, for example, exercising and eating. And then the third volume was on sleep and the biological clock. And the subjects were randomized into these four groups, and each of the four groups got a different combination of these three volumes. So group one was sort of our control group. So they got only the COVID-19 protective measures. All of the four groups got this volume, but then group two additionally got the healthy habits volume, group three got the sleep and the biological clock, and group four got the entire material. And then the first thing we did, of course, was comparing groups, and we did not see any significant difference in changes in anxiety and depressive symptoms between the four groups. And here in gray, you see the people who did not read the material. So we did not see any difference between the groups and between those who reported not to have read it. But then only reading, of course, is not enough if people don't implement changes on their behavior, changes on behaviors to their routines, right? And there was indeed an important variability on how much people followed these recommendations. And in terms of compliance, what we saw is that those who followed the recommendations of volumes 2 and 3 more closely were the ones who had lower scores of PHQ-9 and GAD-7 at time points 14 and 28 days, meaning that they had lower prevalence and severity of depressive and anxiety symptoms. And you see here that the steeper slope is the one in purple, which is the group that got all the three volumes. So the only group that got both volume 2 and volume 3. And here in the x-axis is the adherence to the entire material they got, each of the groups. With that, we concluded that following the recommendations of healthy habits and those who preserve circadian organization was associated with better mental health. But then again, we thought, which habits participants already had at baseline? What comes first, having healthy habits or being mentally healthy? And to address that, we have been developing an app which now assesses also data at baseline and gives the same recommendations, but it is also a first step towards giving personalized recommendations. And with this application, we plan to collect more data. And with more data, we hope to be able to understand which recommendations are better for whom. And we also updated the design and language of the ebook we delivered to the participants. And finally, we hope that with our app, we can also find ways of encouraging people to actually follow the recommendations for a healthier life. Then finally, let us just sum up what we have seen in these two studies I showed you. So in the Quilombola study, access to electricity seems to have had an impact in human sleep and phase of entrainment. And we saw that activity stability or stability and rest activity rhythms has also changed or decreased. That BMI was associated with lower light exposure and higher variability in activity and light exposure daily rhythms. We also saw depressive symptoms that were associated with social jet lag in rural communities, as they were in the previous study in German and Italian communities, and also that low light exposure during the day was associated with depressive symptoms. And both these phenomena, so social jet lag and low light exposure during the day, they probably increased with access to electricity. Then we also saw that different perturbations of circadian organization may be associated with different negative health outcomes. And that this rural-urban spectrum seems to be an interesting natural lab to investigate these associations in real life. Now with the second study, which was the one done in the pandemic, we saw that regularity in routines was associated with a good mental health. That following recommendations on healthy habits and preserving circadian organization also associated with mental health. And all this discussion leads us to think about the way our society is organized in terms of time. And it leaves us with this question of what is normal. And with that, I want to acknowledge the fantastic teams working with me on both studies I showed. They're both multidisciplinary teams, and it's been wonderful working with all these fantastic researchers. And also thank the funding agencies for this financial support, without which most of the science we make couldn't be done. And of course, the participants of both studies. And that is it. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Luisa, for this very interesting talk. Very, very interesting new ideas and concepts, I think. I also have some questions, of course, but I can see that there are other questions in the chat. So I think I will prioritize them over my own. Let's start with the first one from Isabel Hertlen. She asks, can we interpret the data with the depression study to mean that it is more important to expose yourself to light in the morning than later in the day?
Yeah, so in this study, and again, I stress it's a study in rural communities, right? We saw that light in the morning seemed to be more different between the two groups, the one that had clinically significant depressive symptoms and the ones that had lower scores. So what is in the literature is that, of course, there are different ways in which light can affect a mood. And one of them is via the clock, right? And then from that perspective, it seems that light in the morning may advance clocks and then indirectly decrease social jet lag because you have the advanced clocks. We did not test any mediation or anything like that, but from that result, yes, right, what seemed to be more important in that population was light in the morning. But since light can also affect mood directly, not via the clock, it could also be that light at other times has an important effect as well.
So actually the second question goes in the same direction. I think, I'm not sure whether it's about mechanisms as well, but Julian wants to know, could you maybe speak a little more about how light exposure, natural, artificial timing of light influences sleep or health or well-being? And he realizes that it's a very general question. So just in short, yeah.
Yeah, so as I just said, right, you have two different pathways, at least, by which light could affect. One is direct, because there are projections that go directly to the areas that regulate mood. So there is evidence that it could affect mood directly, but also via the clock. So you have, for example, clocks are, as I said, entrained earlier. And then if you have to wake up early to go to work and you are entrained earlier, the less the chances that you get social jet lag are lower, the chances that you get, you know, rhythms that are not that well sort of organized or not that regular is also lower, and that would also affect mood. So I hope that is enough, but I think sort of the two questions are sort of complementary.
Exactly, yeah. Mm. Then there we have another question by Johannes Bintinger. The drugging the clock concept is very intriguing from a drug delivery point of view. If the delivery can be spatio-temporally controlled, can you envision that one could locally restore the circadian time of an organ? Would that even make sense from a biological point of view, as he's a chemist, not a biologist?
Yeah, I mean, thinking on how the clock works, right, and how so many biological processes are under its control, and how targeting it may have different effects, it seems like an interesting strategy. But then, of course, you have a very complex system there, so you would have to understand, or when you do it, you have to understand what are your goals with it and who is benefiting from it. So I think right now we don't have enough technology to get to the point that we locally restore the circadian time of an organ, right? But the idea, so we like to use the orchestra metaphor, in which you have a conductor, which is the central clock in the suprachiasmatic nucleus that gets, you know, signal from light, dark cycles, and then it conveys it to the musicians, which would be the peripheral clocks. And if they're all in sync, you have music, which would be health, right? Instead of having noise, which would be disease. And then if you have like a very well organized orchestra in which, you know, musicians are communicating and they are in sync, in principle, you would have health. And from that perspective, yeah, it would be interesting maybe to target the clock and think on how to get, you know, everything in sync and musicians playing the music and not, you know, playing at different times, which would result in noise. But I think we still need to know better so that we can do it properly, even considering that we have individual differences, right? So different chronotypes and how they react and how, what are the phase relationships that are optimal and ideal. All of that is still, it still needs to be better known, but I think we are on the way of understanding all of that better.
We have another question by Jamie Seisser, who stole my question, actually. Oh, I'm working on similar things, so of course it came to my mind. So he asks, have you looked at other ways to quantitate actigraphic light measurements and how these associate with your outcome measures, for example, time over threshold, centroid, cross correlations, and so on?
Yeah, so one of the things we did back then was checking if the actigraphy measurements, and that's with the Kilombola study, the one in which we compare different communities. So one of the things we did was also comparing all the information we got from activity on sleep and light and see if it correlated with self-reported data. Also on light exposure, because we have that question in the MCDQ that asks how much time did you spend outside without a roof over your head. So that correlated also, I mean, some other metrics correlated better, but that also correlated with a percentage of time spent above 500 lux. I would have to check, I'm sorry. But we did look at these other metrics. It's been a while, but I think the results were similar. And we could, of course, check it again. But the metrics we looked at with light were more related to intensity. And then with the depression story, we looked at the medians. We also looked at different times, and they are described in the paper. But we looked at medians and means, basically, different times of the day.
Okay. Another question by Maristella Di Polettini. Congrats, excellent talking. I'd like to know about age-related differences on circadian stability. Did you take this on consideration in the analysis? And actually, my question would go into this direction. Could you, in general, maybe add more about individual differences and where you checked, and are there any gender, age, whatever differences?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because I mean, even in the pandemic study, right? Because you do see that usually young people are less stable in their rhythm, so their rhythms are more variable. And also in the pandemic, we saw it, and other studies saw that young people had higher scores, which goes with our hypothesis, right? That having less stability associates with more symptoms. So all of our models include age, and we usually adjust for sex too. And some of them we also adjust, for example, in the pandemic for a time in social distancing and how much people reported to this social distancing, which is tricky because at the time we didn't have good questions, right? It was all very new. So how to ask someone how much they're, you know, complying with social distancing. But we had a general question, and that question we usually include in our models to see if that can be a confounder in some way. So yes, we do see that, you know, stability associates with age. So younger people with lower stability, and in the pandemic specifically, we saw this association with depressive symptoms as well. But we also we also adjust the models in the Quilombo study, also always for age. Also because sometimes, you know, even when comparing communities, right, you may have different ages in the groups, but we always correct for that, always adjust for that in the models.
Okay, thank you. I think there's no other question in the Q&A. I'm just going to wait a bit and ask my one. Maybe it's going to be the last one then. But so very interesting about the app that you're developing. One aspect that I'm wondering is, so, you know, how do you actually get this into the daily, or how do you actually reach people in the first place, right? Because with sleep, I think it's sort of, you might get people because they understand the difficulty of sleep, or they have sleep problems already. But with circadian health, often people don't even know, I mean, that this is a thing. So they wouldn't necessarily search for an app, or, you know, you need to sort of educate them in the first place. So how do you envisage how to do that?
Well, in the study it was different because, of course, we invited participants to take part in, and then they would read or they would not read whatever material we gave them. But we still saw that some people wouldn't read it, which was not a high percentage considered. You know, how often long texts might be overlooked, when we were developing the app, one of the things we were thinking is exactly that, right? We want people to want to use it, and we want people to want to see what we are telling them and comply with it. And then what we have been doing is, so we gathered a team that is multidisciplinary. We have students from the design course at the university, for example, and we thought of ways of making it sort of, you know, something that is relatable to whatever age group, whatever sex. So if you look at the, maybe I can go back a couple of slides. If you look at the avatar here, it's something that anyone could relate it. It's not a man, it's not a woman, it's, yeah. And the only thing is that the chronotype, right, that someone gets after they fill in the questionnaires. And we've been, I think that the thing here is we have been discussing this with people from different ages, also in our team. So we have different ages, different scientific backgrounds, and we try to communicate with the people out there that are not in academia to also get from them what they would consider, you know, attractive in such an app. But I agree, it's, I think, the main challenge with this kind of initiative, definitely.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. There is no other question in the Q&A. So I think with this, we can stop here. So thanks all the participants for listening. And of course, thank you again, Luisa, for being here today. It was a great talk. Thank you. With this, I say goodbye, and we'll see.